So, hi guys, this is 69th QS Teams webinar. Today, our speaker is Professor Sayantani Bhattacharya from NYSERC. She's going to speak about entropy current for higher derivative theories of gravity. And she's the third woman speaker in this series. And welcome you, Sayantani, from the same place. So you can start.
Okay, can I switch off the video,
Yes,
stop video?
perfect.
That will be okay. Let me start. So the title of my talk is Entropy Current for Higher Derivative Theories of Gravity. So motivation. So one thing in my talk, I have written down everything. So I'd like if people stop me and ask me questions. So, in Einstein's theory of gravity, black hole solutions behave like thermodynamic objects. They have energy, temperature, and entropy satisfying the first law of thermodynamics. The entropy is given by the area of the black hole horizon and in any dynamics consistent with the EOM, this equation of motion. So, throughout the talk, I'll write EOM for equation of motion. So, in any dynamics consistent with EOM, the horizon area will always increase. And that's like second law of thermodynamics. So the proof of, so in Einstein theory of gravity, black holes are like thermodynamic objects. So whatever thing we identify with energy, temperature, and entropy, they do satisfy thermodynamic laws. And the proof of first and second law use classical EOM along with certain condition of matter stress tensor, which are called null energy condition. Now we all know that the Einstein-Hilbert action cannot be the complete story of gravity. It has many pathologies, like if we quantize it, we'll get infinities. And even in classical theory, classical solutions like black holes, we get infinities. So therefore, this cannot be the full story. And let's assume that there exists some UV complete theory of gravity, which need not be quantum field theory, some theory. So suppose it exists, then any UV complete theory of gravity in its low energy limit will typically generate higher derivative corrections to Einstein's gravity. And such corrections clearly change the equation of motion because the action will change, there is variation will change, equation of motion will change. But the black hole solutions continue to exist in these corrected theories, at least if we treat the corrections perturbatively. But since the equation of motion has changed, the previous proofs of first and second law are no longer applicable. So black hole solutions exist in two derivative gravity as a thermodynamic object. And in higher derivative theories, which will typically be this, the higher derivative corrections, which will generically be there for any other UV complete theory, UV completion of gravity, their black hole solutions still exist. But because the equation of motion has changed, the previous identification of thermodynamic quantities with geometric quantities of black hole is no longer valid, and they do not satisfy thermodynamic laws, like laws of thermodynamics. Now in this paper, World and Iyer, this is a very famous paper where World and Iyer have given a construction of geometric entropy, like in two derivative gravity towards the area of the black hole horizon, and in higher derivative, if we continue to believe that black holes are still thermodynamic object, even with higher derivative corrections, then it should still have an entropy, a corrected entropy. And in this paper, Iyer and World have given a construction of geometric entropy, which will be called here World entropy, that satisfies the first law. But we still do not have a completely general proof of second law involving arbitrary dynamics of black holes in generic higher derivative theories of gravity. So our eventual target is to prove the second law for any dynamical black hole in any arbitrary higher derivative theories of gravity, or to find a counterexample. It is also possible that any arbitrary higher derivative corrections are not allowed by some generic UV completion. So therefore, only in some particular corrections are allowed, and only there we can expect to complete the second law of thermodynamics. So that this is also a possibility. So either to prove or to find a counterexample. That's the final target of this full project. So far it is clear. So
I think it's clear. Yeah.
So now our goal, so this is the eventual target, but at the moment we are very far from it. So at the moment we shall take up a much simpler project. We shall consider a very special kind of dynamical situation, not any arbitrary dynamics, arbitrary higher derivative theory, but a special type of dynamics. So the special type of dynamics is as follows. Like suppose a stationary black hole, we have a stationary black hole in some arbitrary higher derivative theory, and suppose we perturb it slightly by a small amount of infalling matter. The black hole absorbs some matter, goes through a dynamics, and eventually settles into another black hole of slightly shifted thermodynamic parameters. The thermodynamic parameters will be slightly shifted because whatever has gone into the system is a small thing. So that will by hand impose in the dynamics that whatever has gone into it, the stress tensor, the infalling matter is a very small, it's a very small disturbance. The infalling matter is such that the dynamics remains of small amplitude. This will also be an assumption of the dynamics. That infalling matter is such that the dynamics remains of small amplitude throughout, so that we could ignore all terms that are nonlinear in the amplitude of the dynamics. It's a linearized treatment around us, around a stationary black hole, around some arbitrary stationary black hole in some arbitrary higher derivative theory of gravity. We would like to see whether second law holds for such types of dynamics of black holes in arbitrary higher derivative theories of gravity. So second law should hold in any kind of dynamics, not necessarily of small amplitude, but since it should hold for any dynamics, it must hold for small amplitude dynamics as well. So we would like to see that whether second law holds, let's say starting with world entropy, whether within this class of dynamics, entropy is always produced. So this is the simpler project compared to the initial thing, to the initial eventual target. Now I'll come to the plan of the talk. So whatever I said, I'll try to make them more precise in a repetitive way. So the first, you'll define what we mean by second law, at least in this gravitational context. Like what equation, if we can prove, we'll say that, okay, we have proved second law. Then we'll discuss the strategy of the proof, and that will also come in two steps. Once in a physical terms, and secondly, in terms of equations. And some background of our work, like what has already been done. I'll review that, and that's important for the next step that we are taking. I'll describe the final result, and then we can get into the schematic description of the proof. The full proof is not possible to cover here, so I'll just schematically describe some toy calculation. So let's first start with what we mean by second law. So second law says, like the way we are viewing it, the second law says that if perturbing one equilibrium configuration, let's call it equilibrium one, one can reach to another equilibrium configuration, let's say it's equilibrium two. It's true for any system, not necessarily black hole at the moment. So we have one equilibrium configuration, we have perturbed it, it has evolved through dynamics and then settled into another equilibrium configuration in course of time evolution. Then the total entropy of the equilibrium two is larger than that of equilibrium one. So this is what we mean by second law. So second law is satisfied means entropy is evaluated always on equilibrium, and there is some initial equilibrium, there is some final equilibrium which are connected by the dynamics which satisfies some given equation of motion. And the second law, according to us, like so if we can see that the total,
this equilibrium means equilibrium with respect to time.
That I'll come. The next thing is what do we mean by equilibrium? That changes from system to system. Here it means equilibrium means equilibrium with respect to time, but in gravity you might question what is time. Time keeps changing.
Yeah.
So you can choose anything as a time, so that I'll make more precise at what do we mean.
Okay.
But at the moment, suppose you have some notion of equilibrium configuration, you define it depending on what system you're looking at. And the difference of the entropy evaluated on two equilibrium configuration is will be positive if the equilibrium to the second one is an effect of the first one in some sense. Now, in gravity, now just precisely answering Shayantan's question, in gravity, we do the following translation. Equilibrium configuration means a metric with a killing horizon. Gravity means gravity in presence of black hole. Everything is being discussed in this talk will be on black hole dynamics and black holes. So equilibrium configuration means metric with killing horizon. Equilibrium entropy, in our case, will be the world entropy evaluated on the killing horizon. And the second law, in the context of gravity, in our context, will be written as this, that suppose there are two metric, metric one and metric two, both have killing horizons, and the dynamical perturbations around metric one evolves to metric two eventually, then world entropy evaluated on metric two should be greater than world entropy evaluated on metric one. So world entropy is a geometric quantity which, given a metric and given a Lagrangian or action for the gravity theory, there is a precise prescription how to compute the world entropy of that system. And it is always evaluated on the horizon, or rather the spatial sections of the horizon. And the statement of second law, the thing that we eventually finally want to prove is that if you have two metrics connect, both have killing horizons and they are related by some dynamics, then the world entropy of the second metric, which has come later in the dynamics, is always greater than the world entropy of the first metric. So this is the last statement what we want to show. And the crucial point is here that the finally the world entropy, the thing that we are measuring, at least this way of formulating the second law, is something that we are measuring only on equilibrium. This formulation of second law as per doesn't fix the definition of entropy away from equilibrium. It's defined only on equilibrium, and every measurements are done on equilibrium about entropy. Okay.
So I have one question here, Shantani. Yes. So my question, maybe it's very vague, but I'm just asking that why particularly world entropy you are computing, not the other things?
Why particularly world entropy we are computing, as opposed to what, like what else you have in mind in this case? We could compute? Some,
like people used to compute like Bekenstein-Hawking entropy and all. So why particularly world entropy?
Yeah. Okay, Bekenstein-Hawking is the, like world entropy once, by Bekenstein-Hawking, I assume you are meaning horizon area, is that true?
Yeah.
Huh. So if you take world entropy and take its two derivative limit, it will reduce to Bekenstein-Hawking.
Okay.
So world entropy is equal to Bekenstein-Hawking in two derivative theory, and it's the higher derivative generalization of higher derivative generalization of Bekenstein-Hawking.
Okay.
So in this talk, what we'll show that how the proof of second law is not working, we'll schematically we'll show how the proof of second law is not working for Bekenstein-Hawking if we have higher derivative theories. And so we need to correct it, but we will not follow world's route to correct it. So therefore, we will not need the real formula for world entropy. In fact, it is, I'll come to it.
Okay.
Whatever we are doing will reduce to world entropy is one of the statement of the proof. Okay, now I'm coming to the strategy. So this is what we want to prove, and now I'm coming to the part one of strategy, which is some physical description of our strategy. So far, it's clear, or any question at this point?
If guys, you have any question, please ask.
Yeah, hello, I have a question.
Yeah.
So you mentioned that the infalling matter will be such that the dynamics will have small amplitude. Why should it have small amplitude? What happens if the amplitude is larger?
If the amplitude is larger, our proof breaks down. Our proof breaks down. So it's not that amplitude cannot be larger. It can be larger, of course, but... there could be such any kind of violent dynamics, but whatever we are doing is restricted to this particular kind of dynamics, so the amplitude remains small throughout.
Okay.
If you go through the proof, you'll see that this proof will not work. So then we have no statement there. World entropy increasing, decreasing, no statement so far.
Okay, thank you.
So in some sense that a small amplitude is a it's something we are doing to make the calculation feasible. We're not saying that this is the only case possible. Certainly there could be situations where there are large amplitudes. And certainly in those cases also world entropy should increase, but that is our future direction. We have not been able to prove it for any kind of amplitude yet. Okay, now coming to strategy.
I have a question. Hello.
Yes.
What is the difference between world entropy and von Neumann entropy?
Okay, this is a world entropy is something von Neumann entropy. I don't know it much about it, but it's an information theoretic entropy, which is just defined from thermodynamic point of view. Like these many number of states are possible, and then from there you calculate like that way. And world entropy is a geometric calculation. It's an entropy of some averaged out thing. So world entropy does not have any macroscopic interpretation. It's effectively you take a theory of gravity and you calculate something geometric. You take a you take a theory of gravity, you calculate a geometric quantity, and you see that that geometric quantity satisfies something like a first law along with the total energy of the black hole and other quantities. So you identify that with the entropy. You don't know whether this is coming from some microscopic theory accounting of microstates. So world entropy is something constructed very much for gravity black hole theory, and it's an averaged out macroscopic description, like computing the black hole of computing the entropy of the black hole without using any microscopic structure of what microscopic things has constituted it.
And what is the killing horizon?
I really should have given a description. Killing horizon. So we first have to know. Do you know what is a killing vector?
Yes.
Okay. So killing horizon are the horizons whose horizons are null surfaces. So yes. On horizon there is one direction which is a null direction. It's called a generator of the horizon. If that null direction turns out to be a killing vector of the full system, then it's called a killing horizon.
Okay. Thank you.
Now, strategy. Suppose there exists a scalar function. So we want to prove this kind of thing, world entropy 2 and world entropy 1. And both are defined on the equilibrium, on equilibrium only. And we don't have like this kind of statements, the first law and second law, the way we are formulating it doesn't specify what the entropy should be in a dynamical situation. So we have the freedom to correct it. So what we are going to do, like our strategy therefore would be introducing some correction to the expression of entropy in a dynamical situation so that the whole thing becomes an ever increasing function. So let me be more precise. Suppose there exists a scalar function, suppose you could find it, and there exists a scalar function S that reduces to the expression of world entropy whenever the geometry has a killing horizon. So, which means that we have an S, whenever there is equilibrium, it reduces to the expression of world entropy. We don't see for all this formulation, we don't really need to know what is world entropy. It is something geometric can be evaluated on the horizon of a black hole and satisfies first law of thermodynamics if we also know what is the energy and every other parameters of the black hole. Yeah, this much knowledge is enough. So on equilibrium, the entropy of the black hole is world entropy, and we are able to find that scalar function S such that that S, once evaluated in equilibrium, it becomes the world entropy. And then the time derivative, I put the time in a quotation mark because we need to be more precise about what we mean by time in a gravitational situation where there is general coordinate invariance. But let's first take the intuitive viewpoint, there is some time. So time derivative of S is always non-negative as long as the time evolution is governed by equation of motion. So we constructed an S which on equilibrium reduces to world entropy and its time derivative is always positive. Now, once we can have if we can find such an S, the existence of such a function is enough to prove the second law, because LTS is always positive. an S world evaluated on final equilibrium and S world evaluated on initial equilibrium will be the integration of this time derivative from initial time to final time. But the time derivative is always positive. That suppose we have been able to show. So such an extension suppose is possible. Then this thing always positive. So proof of second law, like this will be our key strategy, is to find one such S or prove the existence of one such function S that reduces to world entropy in stationary black holes whenever the black hole is in equilibrium and has a Killing horizon. And its time derivative is always non-negative. So this is the strategy. Now I'll come to the background of our work, something that has already been done and has initiated our work. So in this paper, this 1504, R.N. Merle has almost proved the statement that I have said here. This is, we want to find such a function. And R.N. Merle has almost proved the statement up to nonlinear corrections in the same linearized amplitude approximation. So all nonlinear corrections he has, nonlinear terms in amplitude he has neglected. And after neglecting that, he has almost proved the statement. So proof the statements means that he has found out an S that reduces to S world in equilibrium and whose time derivative is always positive, provided only the linear terms in amplitude are taken care of and all nonlinear terms are neglected. Further, the proof provides, so it's not just an existential kind of proof, it also provides an algorithm to construct the entropy function S world, which from the equation of motion with arbitrary number of derivatives. And this S wall, what wall has constructed, is something defined even away from equilibrium, because S wall is basically this extension function S, which reduces to S world the equilibrium entropy. That satisfies the first law. So this much he has done. So it might, then it feels that we are also in the linearized approximation, then what more we can do, because he has proved it already, I'm saying. But it was not clear that S world, the construction that world has provided, reduces to S world, the world entropy, once we restrict to the stationary black hole. So he has been able to construct a function whose time derivative is always positive, and it's a geometric function. It depends only on the metric and nothing else. And he could show that if the metric satisfies a equation of motion, the higher derivative equation of motion, the time derivative of that quantity will always be positive definite up to nonlinear corrections. But to our understanding, it was not very clear from his proof that whatever S he has constructed will reduce to world entropy, the quantity that is known to satisfy the first law. Remember, we are trying to construct a proof for second law, but it also should reduce to something that satisfies the first law. And that part was not very clear in Merle's construction, though he has argued, and one could indirectly argue, that in equilibrium, S world must reduce to S world, otherwise even the first law will be violated. So that's how he has argued it. It must work, otherwise the first law will be violated. But it was not very straightforward from his proof. So we started our work at this point. So our goal was to study the equilibrium limit of this S world. The entropy that world has constructed and has always positive divergence, whether it is reducing to the world entropy, which we know the only thing that satisfies the first law. So far it is clear. So this is the background of our work. So now we shall describe what we found by studying the equilibrium limit of S world. And now I'll go into a little more technical things like setting up the coordinates and other details. So for that, we need to describe the special coordinate system which used by worlds as well as our construction. So everything has been done in a special type of coordinate system which is adapted to the horizon. So we are coming to that. So coordinate system adapted to the horizon. So whatever geometry you're considering, that must have a horizon, so which is a null hypersurface. On the horizon, we'll define a coordinate V as a fine parameter along the null generators partial videos. Null generators are will reduce to the killing generators of the proportional to the killing killing vectors whenever there is an equilibrium situation. So on the horizon, we'll define V as the fine parameter along the null generators. On, and also on the horizon along constant V slices, we'll define the spatial coordinates xi. Then V and xi together will be the coordinates on the horizon, where V is a null direction. Away from the horizon, we'll define the constant Vxi lines as the affinely parametrized null geodesics, partial R, we'll call that coordinate R, which is piercing through the horizon at an angle which is given by this. We see that del V and del I are the coordinates on the horizon, and this is the dot product, del V del R and del I del R. This one is del V del R is 1, del I del R is 0, and this will fix the angle of the del R coordinates the way they are piercing through the horizon, and their spacing is determined by the fact that they are affine parameters. And choose, we'll choose the origin of the R coordinate such that the horizon is at R equal to 0. Now here is a cartoon of that coordinate system. Suppose this is our horizon. And suppose these blue lines are the null generators of the horizon. So these are null directions. So the constant blue line will take this red surfaces, which is called here del A or del I. These are the special sections. And this green lines are the lines of the R coordinates, which are piercing through the horizon and measuring the distance away from the horizon. So the del V and del I are the coordinates along the horizon. It's a dynamical horizon, it's moving. And these are the red lines, which are affine, the parameter along these lines are affine parameters. So all of them are geodesic. These blue lines are geodesics. The red lines are also, green lines are geodesic. Reds are not geodesic, it could be anything. And these green lines, which are measuring the distance away from the horizon, are called the R coordinate. And these are this is the schematic diagram of the coordinates that we are using, and all our description will be in these coordinates. And we'll choose the origin of this green line, the R coordinates, on the horizon. So wherever this green line has pierced through the horizon, that intersection point, we'll call it R equal to 0. So our horizon by construction will always be at R equal to 0, though it is dynamical. Now in this coordinate system, if we write the metric imposing all the conditions, this affineness, geodesic, this inner product, all these conditions, if we impose, it turns out the metric will have the following form. This dV square coefficient will vanish in R equal to 0, and it will have a double zero. The dV dxi coefficient also will vanish at R equal to 0. R equal to 0 is the horizon, but it's a single zero, and the rest of the thing is just like this. The horizon is at hypersurface R equal to 0, and the metric on constant V slices at R equal to 0 is given by this hij, this one. Because at R equal to 0, this term will drop out, this term will drop out. So it will be just 2 dV dr, but R equal to 0 dr term is not there, so this will also drop out. So it will be only dxi dxj, nothing in the dV square direction. Sorry. So all covariant tensors, and this is some important point, all covariant tensors constructed out of the metric, like Riemann tensor, Ricci tensor, or any other covariant tensor, if you construct it out of this metric and evaluate it on the horizon, it will be functions of this omega I, x and hij and their derivatives. And it's important to note that in evaluation of any covariant tensor, there is no way an explicit factors of v or r or xi could come. There will be v and xi dependence implicitly through this capital X, omega I or hij, but there can't be any explicit r or v dependence, because there will always be just derivative of del V and del R, and everything will be functions of these things, these three functions, this one scalar function X, one vector function omega I, and one tensor function Hij. So this is our coordinate system, and we'll describe our result using this coordinate system. This V direction, this null direction, is actually our time, like this quote unquote time direction along the horizon. So everything, whenever I said that area is increasing or world entropy should be increasing along the time evolution, we meant the evolution along this blue directions, this del V directions. So now we'll come to our final result. So final result is you, just to remind you, first started exploring this thing to fix a problem in Aaron Wall's construction. Wall has a construction which works, which is positive definite, which is an extension of Wall of a positive definite function between two equilibrium. That part has worked out, but it was not clear that Wall will reduce to the appropriate equilibrium entropy, the one that we want that satisfies the first law. So that's how we started our project. We wanted to see what happens to why it's not straightforwardly reducing to it. But what we found is something a little more surprising and interesting. So what we found is the following, that for the type of black hole dynamics we described before, the small amplitude dynamics, we could construct an entropy density JV and a special, not only an entropy density, also special entropy current Ji with the following properties. The JV and Ji locally depend on the functions appearing in the metric and their derivatives. Functions means these functions, the ones that I just now showed, this omega I, Hi, J, X, and their derivatives with appropriate index structure and contraction. In stationary situation, the integration of JV over spatial slices of the horizon reduces to the expression of world entropy and Ji vanishes. There's no current in stationary situation. And JV and Ji together satisfy the following inequality throughout the dynamics of small amplitude. So this thing is positive definite. And where H is the determinant of this Hij, this particular Hij, the metric, induced metric on the spatial sections of the horizon. So this is our final result. We found an entropy density, we found an entropy current, spatial current, and they together satisfy this kind of an inequality for any higher derivative theories of gravity, as long as the amplitude of the dynamics is small. The existence of a spatial current like this Ji makes second law of thermodynamics a very local statement, right, an ultra-local statement. It means that if you take a point on the horizon and take a very small box around it, the net entropy up to the inflow or outflow entropy always increases. So it's true point by point. Previously, all the proofs of second law, even the one that we set out to prove, had an integration in it. It is the total world entropy evaluated over the full horizon section, if I can find it. So this S world is the total entropy of the system. It's not done at point by point on the horizon. So this is what we wanted to prove, and this is what we are looking at. But what we ended up is a bit stronger, and though only up to linear order in amplitude, but it's a bit stronger. We show that even in a gravitational situation, entropy increases point by point at on every sections of the horizon. So now we shall give, we'll get into that, it'll be even more technical. We shall give a schematic description of our proof. So let me pause here a bit and just see if you have any questions at this point about the result or our goal. Okay, if not, let me get into the details. So now I'll again come to strategy and background, but in little more technical terms, since now we have the coordinate system and we know what precisely we mean by time evolution and so on. So now how we prove the second law in a gravitational setup. It turns out the proof of second law in gravitational setup, even for Einstein gravity, is a bit roundabout. So schematically it goes in the following way. We first look at the VV component of the equations of motion. We have called it curly EVV. Equation of motion in gravity is a tensor equation, and it's a symmetric tensor, and the VV component of it we'll be analyzing. And this curly EVV is, we can write it in these two parts, the straight EVV and TVV, where EVV is the part of the equation of motion that involves only metric and no other matter field. And TVV is the matter stress tensor, a matter stress tensor that includes the contribution of all other fields other than metric. there could be metric also in TVV, but all other fields. And EVV is just metric. And we have assumed the condition that suppose TVV satisfies the null energy condition. So TVV is always greater than or equal to zero. This condition itself is named as null energy condition. Then EVV is cast, what we have done in our proof, we'll cast EVV in this form, that a time derivative of this particular quantity which you want to show to be positive definite. So TVV is already positive definite because of the null energy condition, and EVV has just identically could be written in this form. And then EVV equal to TVV, this particular equation implies that this quantity, if I just substitute this quantity in place of EVV, this is always negative definite because TVV is always positive definite and this has a minus sign. So this is always negative definite. So if this quantity is always negative definite, this means this is a del V of something. So this means this quantity whose del V is always negative definite, this quantity is a monotonically decreasing function of V because its time derivative is always negative. So it's a monotonically decreasing function of V. And also we know in stationary black holes, we have a time-like killing vector which reduces to del V up to some proportionality factor, as I have said, because stationary black hole, the null generator of the horizon becomes a killing vector field. So then stationary black hole del V becomes the killing vector field, proportional to the killing vector field. Therefore, in stationary black hole, this del V JV vanishes, and you can also show that by exactly similar kind of argument, Ji will also contain a del V, and therefore del I Ji will also vanish. So this whole quantity will vanish in stationary situations, which will be attained as far future. Because there is a black hole, I have part of it, it is evolving, and in far future, it is reducing to a stationary black hole. So at far future, this quantity is zero, but it is monotonically decreasing. So it is always decreasing with V, and V equal to infinity, it is zero. So therefore, it follows that this particular quantity is positive for every finite V. So this is how the proof is done. So the something we want to show to be positive definite, but we don't directly show that to be positive definite. Rather, we show that its time derivative is always negative definite, and therefore it is monotonically decreasing. And at infinity, it vanishes, and therefore it is always positive at every finite V. Now, is it clear that this strategy is a bit convoluted, but this is how, even in for two derivative gravity, even in Einstein gravity, this is how the horizon area interest theorem calculationally is. This is the algebra that is followed, basically. Okay, now what we have shown here, so what we need to show if this is the strategy is the fact that EVV has this kind of a structure. So EVV has del V of the quantity that you want to show to be positive definite. That was our final result. So we'll end up showing that EVV has this kind of a structure. But let us first explain in this language what has been done already in Aaron Wall's paper. So our work is an extension of that. So in Wall's paper, so the key tricky step here, as I've just said here, is to cast EVV as this form, this particular structure plus nonlinear terms in amplitude. But in two derivative theories of gravity, let me skip this right now, I've already said. But in higher derivative theories of gravity, what Aaron Wall has shown is the following, that Wall, based on some symmetries, argued that almost all the terms in EVV could be expressed in this form. So he has not shown, he didn't show any current, but he has shown that almost all the terms actually could be written like this even without a current. However, this argument does not work for a very few special terms in EVV, and though these special terms are the ones that are responsible for entropy in stationary black holes, and therefore are relevant even for first law. So Aronwall has shown this much already. So this equation that EVV is equal to del V square of something is effectively just the first part of ours. What we have shown is this. EVV is equal to del V square of something plus del V del I of some Ji. But this first part Aronwall has shown almost for all the terms except very few. There are few terms which could where he could not reorganize them in this fashion. But or didn't reorganize them in fashion, because these are the terms that contribute to first law. And he has shown that these terms contribute to first law, so let's not worry about them. That's the kind of philosophy he has assumed. So what we tried to explore these terms, those terms which cannot be written in the form he has written, this del V square JV. So you wanted to explore these special terms. As argued in this paper, as the paper is talking, these terms are responsible for equilibrium entropy, and we know that they must work out in the end. But what we did, we explicitly computed these terms in the special case of four derivative theories of gravity. And we have seen that all the anomalous terms that could not be written in just a double derivative of some JV, all such anomalous terms can be cast as a derivative of time derivative of a divergence of a special current. So there are some terms which could not be written in that form, but they are always written as a time derivative of a divergence of a special current. And see, since they are the total divergence term, if you are interested in a total entropy, they will always integrate to boundary terms, which you can ignore. So then we look for a general. So this we have seen for all four derivative theories of gravity, and then we are looking for a general argument that for any higher derivative theories of gravity, the VV component of equation of motion could be written like this. So if we can show that the VV component could be written like this, then we are done. So we have first seen indication of that in four derivative theories, and then we tried to do it. So now we shall outline the key steps in our proof. So first it will going to get more technical. First, there is an identity for equation of motion in gravity. So the action of the system is gravitational action for plus matter action, where gravity action is given like this, the square root g plus some Lagrangian density of gravity. And it involves only the metric. Now, equation of motion denotes the EAV, denotes the gravity part of the equation of motion. There is a matter stress tensor part, which comes from variation of the matter that we are not concerned at the moment.
So, this theta is the boundary terms?
Theta is the boundary term, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, theta is the boundary term. So, this is the variation of the action. Now, suppose the infinitesimal shift, this delta GAB, is generated by the Lie derivative along some vector direction, vector xi, which is xi partially, some xi. And since S gravity is a scalar under general coordinate transformation, we know how it should transform under a Lie derivative. Lie derivative is an infinitesimal coordinate transformation along the direction of xi. So under coordinate transformation, under this Lie derivative, this variation of the this left hand side will always be of this form. This we can independently derive. And also we know what will be the right hand side. All the delta GAB is generated by this Lie derivative, L xi acting on GAB. So then this equation, once delta is substituted by Lie derivative, will be this equation. Now we know what is L xi of GAB, how metric changes under a infinitesimal coordinate transformation, which is given by this expression. So if I substitute this expression in this L xi of GAB, wherever this then, this will become a function of del S IB, and given that EAB is symmetric, I've written only one term and a factor of two here. Now what I have done is just I've taken a total derivative here in make it del A EAB. So from this line to this line just follows by a change of derivatives. So we'll have something, a total divergence is equal to this quantity. where AB is the gravity part of the equation of motion. So far, it's just algebra, that's writing and changing derivatives, nothing else. And it's an identity. The thing that we are proving is an identity. Now there is a theorem which I have roughly indicated here, but indicated the argument, but let's not into this. There is a theorem that for any diffeomorphistically invariant theories of gravity, the divergence of this AB, this del A AB identically vanishes without using any equation of motion, it will just vanish. So since this will just vanish, the right hand side is zero. So we get the following identity, that this thing is identically zero for any psi A. This particular quantity, it's a vector whose divergence is identically zero. Now also there is a theorem that states that whenever there is a conserved current, looks like a conserved current, locally we could always construct an antisymmetric tensor CAB whose divergence equals to the CA. So if we have a del A CA identically zero, then we could always locally write CA is equal to del B of CAB, where CAB is an antisymmetric tensor. So it follows that because this quantity is just zero, this divergence of this thing is just zero, I have not imposed an equation of motion. You see, if I have imposed the equation of motion, this term would have been zero or related to the stress tensor. I have not done that. I have written it as it is. So it follows that this quantity is equal to del B QAB. So divergence of some antisymmetric tensor, where QAB is some antisymmetric tensor. This QAB is nothing but the dual of the Noether charge as described in our world that finally leads to the construction of Wald entropy. In Wald's construction, those who are familiar with it, they used a Noether charge for diffeomorphism, which finally gives the construction of Wald entropy. And here, this QAB is that. Its derivation is simple. It's just that Wald Noether charge only. So this is the equation that we will be manipulating to see that given structure for UAB. So the final result from step one, contracting with another factor of xi A, we get the following equation. And this is the key identity involving the gravity part of equation of motion that we shall analyze to get the desired result. Now we shall set up a new coordinate system. Okay, the coordinate system I have already set up, it's not new. And adapted to the horizon, we shall see in this derivation, there is no need for a coordinate system. It's always true. We have not specified any coordinate system, but we have already set up a coordinate system. In that coordinate system, we'll substitute this particular equation, and then that coordinate system will evaluate this equation and analyze the each and every term, how the structure could be. And then we shall use a symmetry of the system, the same symmetry that has been used in the paper we mentioned is by you, to determine the structure of each of the terms in the RHS for a special choice of xi A. This symmetry based analysis will finally show the desired structure for the special component of the equation of EVB. So we have fixed a coordinate system, but there is a residual coordinate freedom. So our choice of metric does not fix the coordinates completely. On the horizon, we are left with a set of coordinate freedom. So these are the following. Firstly, we have not fixed the freedom of general coordinate transformation only within the spatial sector. We can take xi is going to yi's, which is function of xi's. This freedom is anyway there. And we also redefine the affine parameter v as follows, that v goes to along every single affine line, we can scale the affine parameter and also shift the origin of the affine parameter. And it does not affect the affineness or our coordinate choice. Mm-hmm. So along with the appropriate redefinition of our coordinate, we could retain the form of the matrix. So this set of coordinate transformation freedom is still left. It's not fixed by our key choice. Now the redefinition of xi is taken care of by making all analysis manifestly covariant. For example, converting all partial i's to covariant derivative with respect to hij. However, the symmetry under redefinition of v is not manifest, and we use it or a special case of it to constrain the structures. The first is, let's look at the special case of this V redefinition. It's reduced to a particular symmetry and the weight distribution in our system. There is a special case of V reparametrization that we shall consider here, which is V going to lambda V, R going to R by lambda. Lambda is a constant. So this is a special case of this. As you can see there, it could be a function of x size, and in particular, they could be constant functions. And that's what we are using here. Under this transformation, partial V goes to 1 by lambda partial V, partial R goes like this. And the covariant derivative with respect to each ij does not transform at all. And all the functions that appears in the metric, this is the metric. So this x, this dv dxi component omega I, and dxi dxj component hij, all those functions will also transform in a given way. None of them will have any overall lambda cofactor like this lambda factor like this del v and del r has, but the arguments inside will change. So now this will, so I have written the metric here for convenience. And we know how a component, so now we want to see that how under this kind of transformation, is basically a coordinate transformation, different components of a covariant tensor transforms. We know how a component of a covariant tensor transforms under any coordinate transformation. So if T is some particular component of a multi-index covariant tensor, under this V parameterization, it will transform as this. It will pick up some powers of lambda. And where this weight W, you could show that this weight W is basically number of lower R plus upper V indices minus the number of upper R plus lower V indices in the covariant tensor. It's a tensor. It has many indices which I have suppressed here. So if we evaluate any covariant tensor component on the horizon, it will be in terms of the above building blocks, this x, omega I, hij, and these partial derivatives or covariant derivative di. And it follows that for any tensor component with weight w, this w will be, see what is the weight w? We can just figure it out by counting the lower and upper r and v indices. But we can further say that the w also relates the number of partial r and partial v. It's basically the difference between the number of partial r and number of partial v. So it turns out that in our horizon adapted coordinate system, the condition of stationarity implies that r and v dependence of the function x, omega I and hij must be through the product rv. And partial v acting on such function will bring down a factor of r and therefore vanish at r equal to 0 unless there is also a partial r to pair with it. In other words, any tensor component with w less than 0 will vanish on a stationary horizon. And also the excess of del v operators over del r encodes the departure from stationarity. This relation between the boost weight, which is the number of lower and upper v indices of a component of a covariant tensor, stationarity, and the number of partial r's and partial v, these three things and their relations is the key to cast UVV to the desired form. The above conditions could be expressed more mathematically with an appropriate choice of xi and Lie derivative along xi. So let me summarize the step here. So far, whatever we have done in our proof. Now we have all the ingredients for the final argument. We shall summarize here the key points. In our horizon adapted coordinates, the metric has one scalar, one vector omega I, and one tensor hij function of boost weight zero. Any covariant tensor component evaluated on the horizon could be written in terms of x, omega I, and hij, and or this partial r, partial v, or covariant I acting on them. Boost weight of any tensor component is defined to be the difference between the total number of lower R plus upper V indices and upper R and lower V indices. The boost weight of any tensor component equals to the difference in the number of partial R's and partial V's. Any tensor component with negative boost weight must vanish in stationary black hole. any term with excess of partial V over partial R is proportional to the amplitude of the dynamics. So these are the key points that will be used to proof, used in our proof. Now choose the xi mu to be the vector generating the infinitesimal version of the above transformation. So now we have to choose this Lie derivative xi, which is, you see, in our equation, the key equation that we will be analyzing, that has a xi in it. So we need to choose that appropriately in our coordinate system so that we can use the symmetry. So we'll be using xi to be the generator of the coordinate transformation that we have just mentioned, under which all the symmetries are mentioned. So xi will be this infinitesimal coordinate transformation where the constant lambda scaling factor is 1 plus delta lambda. So delta v is delta lambda times v, and delta r is minus delta lambda times r. So under this, xi a becomes this, and these are the lower components. And you see xi becomes of zero norm on the horizon with r equal to 0. So it follows that L xi corresponds to infinitesimal version of this V reparametrization we described. And L xi on a covariant tensor is actually equal to the shift generated due to the scaling lambda going to 1 plus delta lambda. One could further show that the stationary black hole xi reduces to the Killing vector of the spacetime. Or in other words, L xi of any covariant tensor would be non-zero only if it is evaluated on a dynamical metric. And further, from the linearity of L xi operator, it follows that it captures dynamics exactly the way we want, up to the linear order and amplitude. Now the final analysis. The identity that we are going to analyze is the following, which has a xi in it. Xi a, we don't have to, this term we don't have to worry, because xi is of zero norm on the horizon. Substituting xi and evaluating it on r equal to 0, this equation, this one, reduces to this equation. And you see we find an EVV. Our goal is to have the VV component of equation of motion in a desired form. And we already have an EVV here. So EVV is a tensor component with boost to at minus 2 because there are two lower V indices. And it does not have any explicit V dependence. As we have said, there can't be any explicit V dependence as such in any covariant tensor component. Now theta r is a tensor component with boost to at minus 1 because it has one upper r indices. And this quantity del mu q mu r, it has, it involves this q, and q v r has w equal to 0, q I r has w equal to minus 1. And both q and theta depends linearly on xi, and therefore could have v dependence only up to linear order. Now the final analysis is repetitively using whatever these properties that we have listed here, all these properties on each of these terms. But we'll do one sample and easy calculation just to show how it works. I'm almost out of time actually. Now we shall use all our relations about boost weight, stationarity, partial Rs to constrain the structures of theta R and del mu q mu R. It is a repetitive application of the above relations for each possible term in a case by case basis. Here we shall present just one such piece of argument to show how it works. Now consider the term in q mu r that depends on xi. This term's q mu r is linear in xi, so there will be one term independent of xi, one linearly depending on xi. This term must have the form of this. So it is contracted with xi, so mu r here and something contracted with xi. And on horizon xi, only the xi v is non-zero, xi v upper, and whose value is v, so it will be like this. This quantity has boost to at minus 1, and this quantity w I r v has boost to at minus 2. Therefore, both must be proportional to the amplitude of the dynamics. Anything with a negative boost to it is proportional to the amplitude of the dynamics. Then I have just explicitly written it out here. And whatever has boost to at minus 2, so there must be 2 del V's, because minus 2 means 2 del V's, and that can't be paired with partial R. And this typical structure, using that fact that it can have 2 partial V, must be of this form. So it can have 2 plus k del v, but k of them could be paired with some partial r. This is a term, these are the terms which has partial r in it, And therefore, k of them has been paired with the partial, k partial are present here, and two are left. And that will account for the minus two boost weight. Now keep going the following, doing the following manipulation. What I'll do, I'll keep transferring del V's here, one by one. And eventually I'll lead to this kind of a term, and this is one term which is nonlinear in amplitude, I'll neglect. So you'll find that this particular term could be written as di of this thing, and which is del V of the sum current. So this is the one desired structure. This is what we want to write, and we could write it like this. So the final steps are using similar kind of arguments, similar kind of restructuring, and using the boost weight, which will control the number of partial V and partial R. We could show that the theta R could have this structure, only this structure. This 1 plus V del V acting on something, then plus del V acting on something. The del mu Q mu R could have only this structure. It's a very restricted kind of structure, but this is the only possibility. And here it is important that factors of V as given are the only sources of explicit V dependence. There is no V dependence anywhere else explicitly. For example, the function A1 and Q0, etc., only have implicit V dependence to the metric functions, but no explicit V. Now we shall substitute this structure into V, V, V. And you see that we can match the coefficients of V. So V to the 0 has to be 0 because left hand side doesn't have any V to the 0, and V to the 1 is equal to this, which is equal to EVB. So you get two equations, and we substitute the first equation in the second equation because you see this A minus 1 appears in both, and then we'll get the desired structure. So EVB becomes del V of some divergence of a current, like a Ford divergence of a current. So here in many places I've ignored the factor. It's a very schematic toy calculation. So many factors have been ignored, but they're important in the final result. But they're not important if you're just interested in the mechanism of the proof. So now I've come to the end of the talk. So this analysis does not only prove the existence, but also gives an algorithm to construct the current, though we have not presented it here in detail. The existence of a special current makes second law of thermodynamics a local statement even in a gravitational setup. This analysis treats the dynamics up to linear order in amplitude. At quadratic order, in Einstein gravity itself, we get entropy production. Since higher derivative corrections are suppressed by some UV scale, it might be possible to argue that such proof at linear order in dynamics is enough to show the second law for higher derivative theories, though the issue might be more subtle. Now coming to the future directions, we have a local version of second law in fluid dynamics and in theories of membrane. There are systems that are near some thermodynamic equilibrium, and the departure from equilibrium is treated in some perturbation scheme. It is possible to construct gravitational dual for both these systems, where the dual system contains a dynamical black hole or black frame. This duality works out even with higher derivative corrections. Now we have a local version of second law, though only for linearized dynamics at the moment within pure gravity. It would be interesting to see, which we are right now following, it would be interesting to see how this fluid or membrane entropy currents map to the gravitational version of the entropy current. Okay, this is the end of the talk. Thank you for your attention.
So if guys, if you have any question, you please ask. Before that, I will just request everyone, those who are attending, please unmute yourself and give a clap for Shantani for giving such a nice talk. So please do that.
Thank you.
And now if you have any question, please ask for clarification. Anyone have any question, please? No question. Is there any question from the audience? Anybody? I don't know.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, please ask.
There's a slide that you wrote, that non-linear term that was del A that you I mean underline non-linear term especially. This page. So but the other term also they see which they which it has also has like AI 0 del V I mean B 0. So I mean is this not non-linear?
It's non-linear in amplitude. So any del V, whenever there is a partial V acting on it, it's like a time derivative of a quantity. So time derivative of a quantity will be non-zero only if there is a dynamics. So this term is proportional to the amplitude of the dynamics. This term is also proportional to the amplitude. So therefore, the product is proportional to amplitude square. So in that sense, it's non-linear and neglected. Whereas here, all the del V's can act on a single object, like here. It has acted on a single object, del V square. So this one is proportional to the amplitude, but this one need not. So therefore, it is linear in the amplitude. This one is quadratic in the amplitude. So this is why it's neglected and it's not. Okay. It's not nonlinear in AI0. It's nonlinear in del V in some sense. Del V acting on something.
Any further question? Any further question from the audience? If not, then thank you, Shantani, for this nice talk. It will be posted in YouTube, and I will share the link with you once it is posted. And stay safe and healthy. So, bye.
Bye. Thank you.